session, we would be talking about Indian monsoons, the factors that affect Indian monsoon, the various theories related to monsoon of India, the phenomena and the basic characteristics. Now to start with, the word monsoon is derived from the Arabic word that is mawsim, and this Arabic word mawsim means season. Now if we try to understand what actually is monsoon, I can say it's the seasonal reversal of the winds that occur over the Indian Ocean and the Indian continent. So Indian subcontinent, if I say there is a seasonal reversal of the wind, that means there is the winds that blows from southwest to northeast during the summers, and during winters they blow from northeast to southwest. So that is the basic characteristic of the Indian monsoon. But in general, if I try to explain what is monsoon and why it is caused, I can say it's due to the differential heating of the land mass and the ocean. So because of the differential heating of the land mass and the water body surrounding it, there would be zone of high pressure and low pressure, and the winds would tend to move from high pressure to low pressure, and it would ultimately lead to rainfall in the continental area. So that is the basic idea behind the concept of monsoon. However, there have been various theories related to it. Now it is a predominant characteristics over Indian subcontinent. There was one of the famous geographers from China, Chan Chi Chiang, who explained the phenomena of monsoon as a phenomena that occurs over a huge landmass. So the important things are, first of all, there is a huge landmass over which the phenomena is occurring, and there is a single direction from which there is flow of wind, and that flow of wind from a single direction would lead to the moisture laden winds that are coming into the region, and this moisture laden wind would ultimately lead to rainfall. So that was one of the definition that was given by this Chinese scholar to explain the concept of monsoon. Now coming on to the factors that affect monsoon, there are five primary factors that affect monsoon. The first is the latitude. Now this section we are specifically focusing on Indian monsoon. So if I draw the map of India here, I can explain that the region north of the Tropic of Cancer, so this is the Tropic of Cancer, for example, that I have made here. The region north of Tropic of Cancer would be the subtropical region, and the region south of Tropic of Cancer would be the tropical region. So that's the first thing based on which the monsoon would be affecting the Indian subcontinent, the subtropical region and the tropical region. The next is altitude. As we move higher in the altitude, what happens is, as the height increases, it becomes less dense, the air becomes less dense, and the temperature falls. So that's the basic thing. As we move over the heights, therefore I can say hills are cooler in the summer seasons. So you have the area of UP, Punjab and Haryana that's hot. However, the altitudinal areas of the hill stations like Ooty, Dehradun, Nainital are much cooler as compared to the low-lying areas. So that was another thing that affects the monsoon, that is altitude. The next is physiography. Now if I again draw the map of India here, the northern region has the Himalayan belt. This Himalayan belt protects the country or the subcontinent of India from the cold air that comes from the Siberia. Suppose if there was no Himalayan range, I could say this Indian continent would have been extremely cold. Okay. On the other hand, I could also say, since there are water bodies that surround the Indian subcontinent, there is a kind of moderate climate. But if there was no water body that surrounded the Indian subcontinent, this region would be extremely hot. So physiography, mainly the role of Himalaya, is very important, and that affects the Indian monsoon. The next is Western disturbances. Western disturbances are caused by the cyclonic activities or the westerlies that blow from the Mediterranean Sea. And this western disturbances affect or cause rainfall or winter rainfall in most of the northern parts of India, mainly in the plains of Punjab, Haryana and Uttar Pradesh. The next is the pressures and the wind. Now, pressure and the wind are important because, as I said, the wind blows from southwest to northeast in summer and this causes rainfall because the winds coming from the southwest are moisture laden. However, in winter, the reverse happens. And again, there is impact of Coriolis force, which we will see later, that affects the monsoonal activities. So these are the primary five factors that affect the monsoon in India. Now moving on to the area in which monsoon activity is predominant, I could say on the world map here, you have northwest part of United States, you have central parts of Africa, the Indian subcontinent, parts of Eastern Asia, parts of Southeast Asia and northwestern part of Australia. These are the major hubs for the monsoonal activities in India. Now coming on, we have talked about the factors that affect the Indian monsoon and what is Indian monsoon per se. Now coming on to the three basic theories that affect the that were propounded to explain the Indian monsoon. The first is the thermal theory given by Halley. Now Halley tried to explain that there is the role of, this is the equator, and there is the role of the ITCZ, the intertropical convergence zone, that moves north during the summer months. Since it moves north, what happens is there is high pressure that is created over the water area and the low pressure over the Indian subcontinent because of the high heat in the Peshawar region. Because of the shifting of the ITCZ northwards, what happens is there is movement of winds from high pressure to low pressure causing rainfall in most of the parts of Indian subcontinent, and that is due to the southwest monsoon. However, during the winter months, this ITCZ moves down south of equator and causes retreat of monsoons. So if we move on to the graph here, you can see you have the summer months in which you have the southwest monsoon and the intertropical convergence zone that shifts north of equator, and during the winter month it shifts south of equator, creating different conditions in both the cases. So you have the thermal theory that explains this. Again, the thermal theory tries to explain as the earth rotates, the trade winds that are in the south hemisphere, that are moving from the south hemisphere, tend to deflect towards the right due to the Coriolis force. We'll be talking about Coriolis force and the various wind and pressure patterns in the class on climatology separately. However, for now, since the wind deflects, it causes again the convergence zone to move here, and that results in the winter months which are devoid of, which are dry and devoid of rainfall. So this is how the thermal theory was given by Halley and tried to explain the importance of the differential heating of the ocean and the land phenomena. The next was Flon's theory. Flon's theory tried to explain the migration of the thermally produced zones of the planetary winds and the pressure belts. However, there were some major criticism that Flon's theory faced. First of all, it could not explain why monsoons arrived early in India, or it was unable to explain the reasons for early arrival of monsoon. It was unable to explain the dynamic nature of the monsoon, why in certain period there is abundant monsoon, why in the other cases there are dry spells. So Flon theory was unable to explain the dynamic nature of the monsoon. It was unable to explain the early arrival of the monsoon. It explained the shifting of the ITCZ similar to the Halley's theory. But again, it ignored totally the concept of jet stream and southern oscillations. So jet stream and southern oscillations were completely ignored by this theory. Therefore, the next was the modern theory, which is the most popular theory in terms of Indian monsoon. Now, modern theory did not limited itself to one single phenomena. It tried to explain the reason for Indian monsoons based on a variety of phenomena. The first was the role of Himalayas. Himalaya act as a barrier and creates and is a major reason for the rainfall in the Indian subcontinent. So you have the Indian subcontinent here and the Himalayan range here. So since the winds coming from here collide with the Himalayas, they tend to precipitate in this region mostly. Then the role of Tibet Plateau. It also explained that Tibet Plateau is a major reason for the rainfall, because Tibet Plateau being located here is at a pretty higher level as compared to the rest of the region that's around it. As a result, there is 2 to 3 degree more insolation in this region. Insolation means the incoming solar radiation. So whatever solar radiations are coming in, this region absorbs it much higher than the surrounding areas. As a result, this becomes a heat zone. So that was another important phenomena that it tried to explain. The next thing that it tried to explain was the effect of El Nino in South Pacific. We'll be covering all these in detail in the further lectures on climatology when we'll be covering. The next was the high pressure zone over East Madagascar. So you have the African continent here and you have the Madagascar. So this region has a high pressure zone, and this high pressure zone leads to winds that blow from high pressure to low pressure and create and cause heavy rainfall in the low pressure Indian subcontinent zone. So the high pressure that centers at the East Madagascar, then there is a seesaw relationship between the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean. So there is high pressure in the subtropical region of the Pacific, and that pressure centers is towards the south of the Indian Ocean. And that is again an important role where we'll be talking about southern oscillations in detail in the further sessions on climatology that affected the southern oscillation that affected the monsoonal activities. So these are some of the primary things that it tried to explain. Besides that, it also tried to include the concepts given by the thermal theory and the flow theory, where the differential heating of the ocean body and the landmass was one of the important phenomena that it covered. So differential heating and again shifting patterns of ITCZ or the intertropical convergence zone. So these were some of the elements that modern theory tried to include and explain why there was a monsoon in a specific region. Now we have already talked about how the intertropical convergence zone shifts. Now the phenomena of monsoon. If we talk about the phenomena of monsoon, monsoon basically can be categorized into three sections: the pre-monsoon showers, the southwest monsoon, and the northeast monsoon. Northeast monsoon is also known as the retreating monsoon. We'll start with the pre-monsoon showers. Pre-monsoon means the showers that occur before the monsoon. If the pre-monsoon showers are good, it is a good indicator of the monsoon in the particular season. Now, pre-monsoon showers are mainly predominant because of the low pressure that centers the northern plain of the Indian subcontinent. Because of the pre-monsoon showers, there have been various terms that have been used. First is cherry blossom, that has been used in the state of Karnataka, and it suggests that this cherry blossom is good for coffee plantation. The next is the mango showers, again in the state of Karnataka and Kerala, and it indicates good ripening of mangoes. And the next is the Kal Baisakhi, that is celebrated in West Bengal, that is again due to good pre-monsoon showers. So these are some of the terminologies that are commonly used in India that denote good pre-monsoon showers. Coming on to the southwest monsoon, as we have explained, it stretches from the month of June to September. The onset of monsoon starts at the coast of Kerala on 1st of June. That's what IMD suggests. So IMD is the Indian Meteorological Department, and it has been providing data since 1878 based on the previous records. We know that 1st June is the time frame where we expect the first rainfall to hit the coast of Kerala during the southwest monsoon. Now what happens basically here is you have the Indian Peninsula, you have the winds coming here. Now as soon as they reach the Indian Peninsula, they get diverted into two streams. One is the Arabian branch and the next is the Bay of Bengal branch. So this is the Arabian Sea. The branch towards the west is the Arabian branch, and the branch towards the wind movements that go along the Bay of Bengal is the Bay of Bengal branch. Arabian branch causes heavy rainfall along the western ghats. Bay of Bengal branch causes rainfall along the eastern ghats and parts of the southern, the western plateau of Meghalaya, mainly the Mysoram and the Cherrapunji region. And finally, both of these meet at a region of Indo-Gangetic plain where they cause the maximum rainfall to occur. So that is how the southwest monsoon proceeds in India, and Himalaya acts as a great barrier because beyond Himalayas you usually do not see ample of southwest monsoon that flows up. So that is how the southwest monsoon blows. The next is the northeast monsoon or the retreating monsoon. During the months from September to December, there is retreat. So if I draw the map of India, I would say the monsoon starts of 1st of June, then 5th June, and so on till September here. And finally, the retreat is much gradual as compared to the arrival of monsoon, and the retreat starts in the month of September from the westernmost part of India, and it retreats most of it by the month of October and November, finally leading to winter rainfall in the southern parts or the coast of Tamil Nadu, I would say, receives winter rainfall due to accumulation of moisture laden winds of the Bay of Bengal branch, and this retreat finishes by the mid of December. So that is how retreating monsoon occur. Retreating monsoon is associated with clear skies, lot of sunlight, increase in temperature and decrease in the moisture content. Now there are some important things that cannot be ignored, I would say, in the monsoons in India. The first is the role of Tibet Plateau. As explained previously, Tibet Plateau is a very important part or very important element that explains the monsoonal activities in Indian subcontinent. Now, what is exactly the role? Tibet Plateau, as I said, is at an elevation of is at an elevation which is higher than the low-lying areas that surround it. As a result, it receives more insolation as compared to the other regions, and is a kind of heat zone that is being established in this region. Now what happens basically is, during the summer months, you have the subtropical westerly stream, you have the subtropical westerly jet. As the name suggests, it is blowing from the westerly direction towards the east. So it's blowing towards the east, and this subtropical westerly westerly jet stream that's blowing towards the east creates low pressure zone here and the high pressure zone in the Peshawar area. As a result, this region lying towards the northern plains of India, mainly the region of Punjab, Haryana and western part of Uttar Pradesh, receive winter rainfall because of it. However, in the winters what happen is, you have the easterly jet stream, the tropical easterly jet stream that blows, and this tropical easterly jet stream in summers lead to southwest monsoon that hit the coast. So you have the tropical easterly jet stream that starts from the east coast and moves towards the west and causes southwest monsoon in the summers. So you have the tropical easterly jet stream during the summers and the predominance of the subtropical westerly jet stream in the winters. Both of these affect the phenomena of monsoon in the Indian subcontinent. We would be covering these jet streams in detail in the class on climatology. Now next, moving on to the characteristics of monsoon. As explained previously, India is a land of monsoon. So you have a kind of huge variability in the amount of rainfall that is received in the Indian subcontinent in different months. So if I try explain about the onset of monsoons, onset means arrival of monsoon. So it's expected to arrive or hit the coast of Kerala by 1st June, and by 15 July you have, it is well established towards the western, northwestern most part of the Indian subcontinent. However, there is important thing to understand that this monsoon is characterizing around 90% of the rainfall that happens in the Indian subcontinent. It's highly dynamic in nature. Its intensity can vary from different period. As explained, there can be changes in the onset of monsoon. So there can be early arrival of monsoon or late arrival of monsoon, depending on various factors that we have discussed, along with the El Nino and the La Nino effects. We will be talking about those in more detail on the further sessions in climatology. However, there are breaks in the monsoon, and these breaks lead to dry spells. So if there is a rainfall in the region and there are subsequent breaks in the region, it might be like for 3 to 5 days consequently there is no rainfall. So there is a kind of dry zone that happens in a specific region, and that is what is known as break of the monsoon. Similar to break of the monsoon, there is burst of the monsoon. Burst is similar to the onset of the monsoon. And finally, we talk about the withdrawal of the monsoon that occurs from the month of September to December. You have the retreating monsoon or the northeast monsoon that moves back. Now, we have talked about the characteristics, the phenomena, but besides these, there are lot of regional variations that occur in the monsoonal activity. The first is temperature. So if we talk about the Indian subcontinent itself, you have the desert of Rajasthan at a temperature of around 55 degrees Celsius. On the other hand, the Dras and Kargil with a temperature of minus 45 degrees. Then the direction of rain bearing winds. Direction of rain bearing winds also vary significantly. You have Western Ghats where you have the Arabian branch that hits, and it causes higher rainfall as compared to the Bay of Bengal branch, which causes rainfall in the Eastern Ghats. So that is, the direction of the rain bearing wind is again very important factor in determining the amount of monsoon in the various parts of the country. Then forms of precipitation. Forms of precipitation can vary significantly. So you have the region of Punjab, Haryana and Rajasthan with low rainfall. However, the region of Kashmir Hills or the Kashmir Valley would have snowfall. So there can be huge variations in the form of precipitation across the continent. The amount of rainfall also varies. You have a rainfall of less than 20 centimeters towards the western side in Rajasthan. However, the region of Maisrom and Cherrapunji can receive as high as 1080 centimeters of rainfall per year. Then there is seasonal distribution of rainfall. Seasonal distribution of rainfall explains that most of the Indian subcontinent receives summer rainfall. However, the region of Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh coast receive winter rainfall. So there is seasonal variations, or the seasonal distribution of rainfall varies. Also, because of the western disturbances, you have the northern plains of India that witness winter rainfall. So winter rainfall in the northern plains of India is another important characteristic. However, this winter rainfall in the northern plains is good for rabi crops, mainly wheat and lentils. So this was the basic idea behind the Indian monsoon. We have talked about the various factors, the theories, the phenomena and the characteristics of Indian monsoon. We will be covering more sessions related to climatology, where we will be talking about the various terminology, the pressure belts and the wind belts in detail. In the further classes, you can subscribe to our videos For further updates on climatology, have a good day ahead.